and welcome. You're watching Head to Head. I'm Antonina Antosha with UATV. The International Monetary Fund backed Ukraine's plans for an anti-corruption court. Its creation was among the conditions for unlocking the next $2 billion tranche of financial aid to Kyiv. At the same time, a number of other issues remain to be addressed. One of them is raising gas prices. To talk more about Ukraine's cooperation with IMF and the probability of getting new tranche from IMF, we welcome in our studio today Pavlo Kukhta, advisor to the Prime Minister's Strategic Advisory Group for Support of Ukraine's Reforms. Hello and thank you for joining us. In general, how are we doing in terms of reforms so far?
Well, I'd say we're moving along. The glass is, as usual, half full, half empty. Mm-hmm. Depends on how you look at it, but at least there are some achievements. But question is, at this point, especially with the cooperation with the IMF and with mm-hmm. regard to specifically getting the IMF tranche and moving forward, is not so much reforms per se or structural reforms, but simply preserving the macroeconomic stability of the country and getting through a very specific and tough period of very high payments on foreign currency denominated debt. Mm-hmm. Which is, total was almost $20 billion in 2018, 2019, 2020. Mm-hmm. The overall total, it's about more or less evenly distributed, a bit more in 2018, 2019, a bit less in 2020. But generally, this is not a normal or standard period of, you know, working. We really need to attract large external financing to refinance those debts. Otherwise, we would be very hard pressed to find the necessary resources within this economy.
Okay, so what are we doing in order to achieve that?
This really requires us to get the next IMF tranche. Why? Because our access to market, to the international debt markets, we will not have it without mm-hmm. the IMF tranche, without the IMF program moving forward. The macrofinancial assistance from the EU, which is $1 billion, and the $800 billion from the World Bank as part of another macrofinancial assistance program, are also conditioned on the IMF program. Mm-hmm. So everything is kind of tied together around it. So we really need to get the next tranche from the IMF, unlock this official financing from the EU and the World Bank, and then get into the financial markets, borrow money there, mm-hmm. and then we'll be able to at least more or less safely come through until the end of 2018 and mm-hmm. in 2019.
But there are some requirements in order to have this next tranche.
Exactly,
from IMF.
The IMF conditionality. So one is fulfilled now, the anti-corruption court. Mm-hmm. Hopefully the president will now sign the final amendment that was necessary to it, and then it's done. It's a done deal. This was even signaled by the IMF in the media. Mm-hmm. So the second thing, there were some issues with the budget, but they were more technical and seems like they will be handled on a technical level without any kind of political decisions taking
That's
place.
Good.
So one thing remaining are the gas tariffs, which are obviously a tough issue.
Speaking about that, it's been called like a reform for NAFTA gas, but people, ordinary Ukrainians, due to the fact that they were not explained what is actually happening, they see it as just a simple raise in the tariffs for gas. Clarify.
Okay, well, first of all, never in the history of the world in any country have raising tariffs been popular with the people. So it's an illusion that you can really explain. They will not like it.
Agreed.
Anyway. No one likes that. So unfortunately, that's the fact. Mm. Why is it happening? It's actually a part of introducing the gas market. So to get the gas market, to actually get suppliers and competition and businesses coming into provide mm-hmm. that gas to the population, mm-hmm. you need market prices, because otherwise they will not be able to earn money, and they will not come there. Right? So as long as you do not have market prices there, you are really stuck with this Soviet administrative system of supplying the population via the state company. Mm-hmm. Why it is a problem? Because it is actually why the West and the IMF insist on this so much? Because this is actually at the root of Ukraine's problems from the very beginning of its independence.
This
is
where prices.
The gas prices, exactly.
Not corruption, not the hybrid war, gas prices.
Well, let's put it this way. Where did Ukrainian corruption come from? It came from the gas market in the end of the 1990s. The big oligarchs were created in the gas market.
So
this is kind of the root of all evil.
Okay, so it's how raising tariffs would eliminate corruption?
Well, actually, the corrupt system in there was pretty simple. So you had cheap gas that was supplied to the population by administratively regulated prices, which were cheap. Mm-hmm. And then you had the industry, which paid market prices. Mm-hmm. So essentially what happened was people diverted the gas that was supposed to go to the population, pretended it was for the population, paid for it like it was for the population, then resold it to the industry at huge, like 90% arbitrage.
And the difference went to the pocket.
The difference went to the pocket, and the difference was huge, like 90% of the price. So the tariffs for the population were 10 times lower than they should have been. They were very significantly raised. So at this right now, they're about one-third lower because gas prices went up. So it's about one-third right now there. Below the market. And in theory, to close the gap, to avoid this arbitrage, you do not even need maybe to raise them fully. So some kind of hike where the arbitrage opportunity will be small, it will not be easy to earn money there, then you eliminate corruption there. Another thing important there is that market prices, they are essential to signal correctly to the people, if we're speaking in economic terms, how costly this resource is, how careful you have to be using it, right? So when the prices were extremely cheap, people used this gas for everything, and the industry as well, because they still embezzled this gas for the population. So this created the most energy inefficient economy in Europe, Ukraine.
Because of the corruption, again.
Because of the corruption, but the root of that was this administrative regulation, right? Mm-hmm. So which was supposedly benign to the population. Mm-hmm. So this distorted the economy so much that created essentially, you know, an oligarchic system, corruption, everything. If this is not the root of the problem, it's one of those roots of the problems here in Ukraine. It also
not that you've explained it. I totally agree. That's true.
Okay, so another dimension. The geopolitical dependence on Russia, which was very much tied to dependence on Russian gas supplies, came from there. You know, if Ukraine was much more energy efficient, so consumed much less gas. If there were no opportunity for arbitrage, for corruption, for doing these games with cheap Russian gas that would then be sold at higher prices, etc., Ukraine would probably be energy independent by now, because it would probably be able to cover its own needs by its own production and probably even start exporting gas. Mm-hmm. So we would not have a lot of issues, even geopolitical issues that go beyond Ukraine's borders would not exist, which is where this condition came from. So it's kind of understandable why the IMF insists. It's also kind of understandable why the authorities, half a year before presidential elections, are reluctant to do it. Obviously, politically, this is tough, and this is never popular with the population. It's an illusion that people can be persuaded that, well, very rarely, maybe.
Especially in the society when salaries are not raised that much.
Salaries rose like 40%, I think, in real terms, after we count inflation out throughout the last year. But still, people kind of perceive this. They are used to low tariffs. They haven't changed mentally. Of course, it's important to explain to them, but I personally don't.
How do you explain to this?
Just like I did right now, I guess. But I'm not, you know, I'm not sure they will buy it fully, you know, right now. Maybe later. Maybe they will understand it.
In general, would you give the evaluation of Ukraine, of the state of Ukrainian economy these days?
Well, if you discount this issue of the country being potentially even possibly defaulting, right? Yeah. If we're not able to secure this finance, if you discount that, the economy is actually, I can't say it's booming, but it's moving along, right? And the critical problem, so at least it's not stuck like it was in Yanukovych times when it didn't grow at all and wasn't capable of growing and kind of consumed itself. So it was just spending foreign exchange reserves and slowly going towards the crisis, which then happened. So apart from this issue of these debt payments, it's at least more or less healthy. So it's capable of moving forward, it's growing. The growth is not fast enough. That is the critical issue, of course.
Do you have the numbers?
I think it's 2.5% of GDP forecasted for this year, maybe 3%. They kind of change a bit. I think the latest from the National Bank was 3%. A bit lower next year because elections and political instability.
Now, what about the war in the east of Ukraine? Does it take away our percentage of the economy?
It's already there, I'd say. I think it took off, you know, the half or even more, or two-thirds of the fall in GDP in 2014, 2015 was caused by that. So that's kind of in the numbers already. You know, there is no war in Kyiv, right? It's growing.
Obviously, Kyiv is not the only city, even though it's a capital, it's not the only city in Ukraine.
It's a factor. Of course, the war is a factor. It's keeping investment out to some extent, but it's not the only one, definitely.
Of course. All right, well, thank you so much for coming and clarifying the whole gas situation here and giving your forecast. Thanks again. That was Pavlo Kukhta. He's an advisor to the Prime Minister at Strategic Advisory Group for Support of Ukraine Reforms. Thank you so much for watching. Stay tuned with UATV for more.